You are all welcome to the Indian Institute Advanced Studies Program, Book Reading and Author Public Interaction. Today we are going to do the book discussion about the letter with guest line on language and mathematics, authored by Professor Inakshi Re Mitra, who is with us. I'll also give her introduction before that. She has done her PhD from Jadavpur University, Kolkata in 2004. और उसके बाद अभी 2005 से वो दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय में दर्शन शास्त्र विभाग में कार्यरत हैं और सन 2013 से 15 में वो हमारी फेलो रही थी, भारतीय उच्च अध्ययन संस्थान की फेलो रही थी। माफ करना, मैं अपना परिचय देना भूल गया। मेरा नाम अखिलेश पाठक है, मैं जनसंपर्क अधिकारी हूँ भारतीय उच्च अध्ययन संस्थान में। तो आप सभी का स्वागत है और हमारे वक्ताओं का और प्रोफेसर इनाक्षी मित्रा का भी बहुत बहुत स्वागत है। ज़्यादा समय न लेते हुए मैं कार्यक्रम को आगे बढ़ाते हुए प्रोफेसर इनाक्षी देव मित्रा को और हमारे आज के वक्ताओं को, प्रोफेसर अनूप धर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ लिबरल स्टडीज फ्रॉम अंबेडकर यूनिवर्सिटी, एंड प्रोफेसर नीलांजन भौमिक, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फिलोसफी फ्रॉम DU, उनको स्वागत करता हूँ स्टेज पर। प्लीज़ आए, स्थान ग्रहण करें। कार्यक्रम को आगे बढ़ाते हुए एक और हम आज चाहते हैं कि थोड़ी और नई परिपाटी की शुरुआत की जाए, चूंकि ये पुस्तक से जुड़ी हुई चीज़ है, बुक से जुड़ी हुई चीज़ है। तो नॉर्मली प्रोग्राम्स में बुके दिया जाता है, हम चाहते हैं कि हम बुक देकर सभी का स्वागत करें। तो मैं प्रोफेसर मीनाक्षी मित्रा से कहूँगा कि वक्ताओं को पुस्तक प्रदान करें। प्लीज़ पहले प्रोफेसर अनूप धर को पुस्तक प्रस्तुत करें। प्रोफेसर नीलांजन भौमिक को भी प्रश्न प्रदान कर, इसी के साथ अब आज के प्रोग्राम की हम शुरुआत करते हैं। मैं मंच प्रोफेसर इनाक्षी मित्रा को सुपर्द करता हूं। मैडम प्लीज आप।
थैंक यू अखिलेश जी। आई थैंक इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ एडवांस स्टडीज फॉर टेकिंग दिस you know, program, arranging of this program. It's the first program they're arranging regarding authors common and readers and author interaction. And I also thank all of you to take the trouble to come, to appreciate this program and to come. And I also thank the speakers, Anuthar of Ambedkar University, Department of Liberal Studies, and of course Dr. Niranjan Bhumi, who is my colleague. They have very graciously, you know, agreed to speak on my book at a very, very short notice. Now, the way we have conceived this program is roughly this, that, you know, I'll, you know, take my advantage of being the author of the book and speak about the book about 5 to 10 minutes. And then I'll invite Professor Clark to speak on my book, to present his reflections on the book. And then perhaps I will, he might have some questions to me. And maybe I'll take 5 minutes to answer the questions, and then I'll ask Dr. Niranjan Bhumik to make his critical reflections about the book, and then I'll take 5 minutes to answer the questions. After that, the session will be open to audience interaction. Or alternatively, we can have both the speakers put their reflections at one go, and then I can respond. And after that, we can have an open interaction with the audience. So, okay, let me just start. What I wanted to do is to introduce the theme of the book and to have a rapid clarity. Just saying in a very brief nutshell what exactly Vignesh wanted to do by way of critiquing the foundations of mathematics. So first of all, you know, it is very easy to appreciate that, see, mathematics cannot be based on real foundations because the reality is so dissipated, messy, interpenetrative. And where is, and with this qualitative exuberance, and there is what mathematics needs is to say very simply, very neatly chiseled out units, not getting into any interactions, paradigmatic units, interaction free, isolated units. So mathematics cannot be based on a real foundation. So here you see the scope of formalism in mathematics comes up with people like philosophers like Russell. They say that, look, mathematical language, they don't talk first order about any objects. you know, if you say that to talk about numbers, to talk about classes of classes, then they don't commit themselves to there being classes of classes as real entities, but it's a second level talk. So mathematical talk is not a first level talk, but it's a second level talk about properties of a class. When you say that, you know, when you speak of number five, what you're saying is that, you know, the five-membered set has the property of having a 1-1 correlation with another coextensive set. So this whole talk about reference, I mean, there is no reference when mathematical propositions are being presented, but the first level talk is to be transferred to second level. Okay? The whole thing is, has some interesting similarity with all we know that when you talk about, when you have empty terms like present king of France, then it's not a first level talk, but it's rather a talk about a property, some property having unique instantiation. So more or less that kind of strategy is used by logicians. But you see, here the problem is, as Whitney Stein would say, that logicism also lapses into some kind of criticism or realism. Because what you are doing, that while you are posing that we are really engaging in a second level talk, and you are prioritizing concept and not the object, you are not saying that you know, we are not committing ourselves to there being set of sets or whatever, but then what you are doing is you are actually investing the concepts with a foundational content. You are saying that the concept of the classes of classes, they have a foundational content which anticipates or which foreshadows its applications. And so here the foundational foundational element creeps in, which it, you know, ceremoniously tried to reject. So and here you see, so we had realism and we have logicism, and we have logicism having the tendency to lapse into realism. And here you see formalism comes in. And formalism says that, look, mathematics is neither about Platonic entities, nor about concepts, but it is about science and sign transformation. And there you see Hilbert, the main exponent of formalism. He said, interestingly, the signs are the full-blooded realities. They have number, they have structure, they have properties, they have relations, they have everything. And they have numericity embedded to them. They don't have to go outside to represent numbers because they have numericity, structure, speciality, temperature, everything embedded to them. So they are full-fledged realities and they have a pre-conceptual extra-logical character. In a way that you see, they don't allow themselves to be multiply interpreted. The problem is that with foundationalism, that you know, whenever whatever you point as foundations, they are becoming dissipative or multiply interpreted. That problem will not come with science, because with science they have a transparent, extra-logical, intuitive character, and so how they are to be generalized, how they are to be subsumed under concepts, and from the concepts how they are to be again, you know, secured as instantiations, that is totally transparent. There is no multiple interpretations, there is no scope of them putting them under different concepts. So that was the the uniqueness of that was the unique claim of Hilbert. And here you see Wittgenstein has a strategy which will take care to refute both formalism and also and logicism. Because what he would say that, you know, with formalism, with logicism, what he was trying to do, that look, mathematical propositions, they elevate themselves from their pictorial character, from their multiple interpretive character, and they become abstract. They are only logical rules. They can put an unsurveyable mass under the aegis of logical rules. And there you see, the foundationalism creeps in. And whereas formalism is trying to put a foundational transparent character into the science, the Wittgenstein won't accept any of them. He would say that, look, mathematical proofs, they are ultimately surveyable patterns of sign transformation. Because they are the mathematical proofs, the science cannot go beyond science to represent something. But at the same time, he would not also say that science have a transparent extra-logical character. Because he would say that science also have, you know, this, they have historicity. Then they have, they are also penetrating with their background, with their surface. And so science are also, you know, there are many ways in which science cannot be held to have a kind of insular status as, you know, terminal, units of space where they refuse to interact with the larger scheme of reality. You cannot resist the science from being penetrating or dissipating into So that was what, so what happens in mathematical proof, it is an activity. There is nothing which is, you know, pre-applicational foundation either in the shape of Platonic entities or in the shape of rules or in the shape of science themselves. So what you do is that every step there is an aspectual enclosure between the premise and the conclusion. And that aspectual inclusion is, you know, is ultimately a matter of activity and ultimately a matter of form. So what I want to say in conclusion is that Wittgenstein's critique of mathematics is to be seen, I've tried to see it as an extension of critique of general language, general non-technical language, and I've tried to show that how the critique of mathematical language is also an extension of that general mode of critique. And secondly, you know, Wittgenstein has no intention to denigrate mathematics. Critiquing the foundations of mathematics is not to, you know, kind of to denounce the superlative level of rigor of mathematics, but rather I should say that to see that how in every step there is an aspectual enclosure which is not founded upon anything, you know, it is perhaps a mathematician himself is best suited to approach that. Thank you. Now I invite Professor Anuktha of American University Department of Liberal Arts to present his observations on that.
Thank you, Inakuti. I have been reading this book, not that I am fully satisfied with my reading, because it requires a little bit of rereading, is my feeling. However, let me make an attempt to respond, reflect on the work actually. I would put the book, though mathematics is foregrounded in the book, it is the foreground of the book, I would still put the book in the genre of the kinds of work that have been usually titled "What is Philosophy?" I'll come to that at the end. Why I felt this take on Wittgenstein was in a way a reliving of the question, "What is philosophy?" And I'm remembering two works over here, Heidegger's work on what is philosophy, Deleuze and Guattari's work, What is Philosophy? And I was, in a way, actually reading it from where I can, in that sense. But I'll come to that at the end. I will start with two lines I glean out of the book, which may make a possible entry into the work, which is a beautiful work, I must say. This is the line: "It is essential to the dignity of military uniforms that the soldiers be also seen in ordinary civilian clothes." So this is one line I wanted to pull out of the book. The other line I would like to pull out: "With the ancient belief about the earth and the sun, that the sun moves around the earth, and the modern view that the earth moves around the sun, it is clear that is not the same sun and the same earth," though that is how we tend to present it, as if it was earlier the sun moving round the earth and now it's the earth moving round the sun. But what was poignant actually was the two italicized "same." It is not the same sun and the same earth that presents itself this way. and I've already said, I will put the book in the genre of what is philosophy, but within that, one area that, you know, generated a kind of engagement in me was the detailed discussion in the book, and it keeps coming back, it comes at the beginning, what is a concept? And spinning concepts, laying fiber on fiber, and the way the idea of the concept is opened up in the book, I'm tempted to read just one line from there. I shall, however, consciously start with a minimalist interpretation of the notion of family resemblance and the fiber-on-fiber account of concepts. Ironically, this leaves us with a multiplicity of temporary and short-ranged features in lieu of classical universals, thus retaining the overworn dichotomy between particulars and properties, and perhaps also a version of the Augustinian model of concept formation, the model that Wittgenstein rejected both in detail and in principle. And I thought this really opened up for us. And the engagement with the Augustinian model is there all throughout. I'm not getting into that. The second element of the book, and it's also written very well, I must say. You write very well, she has a purchase with the English language. And from time to time I would stop, oh, this line is beautiful. The second part would of course be language. The third would be philosophy. Let me restrict myself to these three. I glean out of the book. There are many others. I cannot do justice to the book. And it's my incompetence actually that I cannot do full justice to the work. One is concept, and it will keep coming back. The second is language. The third is philosophy, which is what I want to end with. What I found interesting was the attempt at breaking the kind of bond we find ourselves, at least in the kind of philosophy I do, between essentialism and nominalism, because I largely come from what is called the continental, the post-structuralist tradition of philosophy, and the way the book opens up essentialism and nominalism and makes space for a kind of philosophical anti-philosophy, if I may put it this way. When essentialists insist on a common stock of words and common descriptive essence shared by all language games and forms of life, they are virtually turning language into inert, ghostly entities. The essentialist endeavor compares with cutting the limbs off the entire organism, wrenching the different handles and displaying those severed parts with a great flourish as the common underlying essence. Severed from the forms of life, words and sentences too are merely printed marks and sounds that are traditionally presented as the common essence of all language. And this is what the book takes head on. The picture of language that emerges in later Wittgenstein, or late Wittgenstein, is a dramatic contrast with the Augustinian. And Pragati opens up later with Wittgenstein in an interesting way, where the author or the philosopher comes alive, and in that sense the later part of the book is not just on what is philosophy, but who is a philosopher, what is the task of the philosopher, what is philosophical praxis. And in that sense, I thought the book took us very close to what would be the praxis of philosophy. What is the work of what is the work a philosopher would do? The author of Tractatus had to traverse through real spaces, and not just through logical space, through real time, and not time as a fixed form of objects. He had to play out newer and newer language games, live through newer and newer forms of life to appreciate the language is as complex, as indeterminate, and as unpredictable as life itself. With new forms of life, new language games emerge, while older ones get obsolete or forgotten. One cannot predict a new move of language any more than she can predict a new form of living. And here, I don't have questions for you in Akhidi. I just would want you to reflect, if possible, for my learning primarily, on two questions. The question of time, and second, the question of palaeonic, the weight, the historical weight, and we get palaeonomy, like Paleolithic, a Stone Age too. What would happen to a Stone Age kind of word or term, the kind of stasis, the inertia it would hold, the kind of hold it would have on us. What would happen to that in the kind of language as usage. What would we do with the weight of it in that sense? It's just a conflict in me, actually. The second would be the question of time. The book manages to open up language, life, and form of life in a kind of overdetermination, a mutual constitutivity. How much time do I have? Not much, right? In that sense, it opens up a second question, as it opens up language, the question of mathematical language, mathematics as language, and a very important line from the book, and I quote her because I don't want to present it myself. Once we appreciate asking, thanking, cursing, greeting, praying as forms of life, we appreciate other games, like describing the appearance of an object, constructing an object from a description, testing and forming a hypothesis, presenting the results in an experiment, the results, or predicting that certain things will happen as forms of life too. And then it is also a short step to realizing that mathematical games too, the games of freezing, experiments, turning experience into paradigms, are as much woven into our ways of life as other activities like thanking, cursing. It is true that unless one participates in such forms of life as experimenting, measuring concrete objects and forming hypotheses, one cannot freeze experiments, turn hypotheses into definitions. However, freezing an experiment is not freezing life or abstracting from it, but is a form of living itself. And this is fundamental, actually. We have hitherto thought that freezing
an experiment is freezing life, is abstracting from life. But is it, and this is a powerful question the book raises, is it a form of living itself? Is it part of the forms of living? Mathematical propositions then need to be thought differently. It is to not to conceive of mathematics as a stoppage of language games, but rather an emergence of a new game, a new technique, a new mode of activity. And here, actually, in Akadu, you managed to do something interesting for me, actually. We usually tend to raise the question within philosophy and then come to philosophy of mathematics. And that is our usual trend. Though Plato's debt to geometry, Kant's debt to physics, Deleuze's debt to biology can be seen very, very differently. That it doesn't, that philosophy doesn't happen first, and then we have philosophy of science or philosophy of mathematics, but it could be the other way around, actually. That could be an interesting way, and you do that very well in the book, I felt. Wittgenstein uses mathematics as a privileged entry point into his philosophy, rather than the other way around. Philosophy of non-essentialism. He cited the concept of number at the very outset as a prime example of family resemblance. His idea was to extend the family resemblance character of mathematical language to language in general, while we usually find it convenient to adopt the reverse order in our reading of Wittgenstein. And this, I thought, was a really, really valuable reading. Speaking of the continuous adding and dropping of fibers in the open corpus of language, Wittgenstein comments, quote, "We can get a rough picture of this from the changes in mathematics." It's the other way around, actually. It's from mathematics that the kind of philosophical insight is generated. On another occasion, and I quote her, where he emphasizes the inherent indeterminacy and incompleteness of language, he brings in the example of mathematics. "Ask yourself whether our language was complete, whether it was so before the symbolism of chemistry and infinitesimal calculus was incorporated into it. Thus, mathematics is an open nexus of language games." And in that sense, it is a reversal. It is not the other way around. The author argues how one has to appreciate the form of life character of mathematics, as well as other non-mathematical languages, and how it has resulted in what we now call later Wittgenstein. Actions are not the consequence of language, but language is an extension of this consensus of actions or forms of life. I'll not get into, I don't want to take up more time, the nominalist question over here. I thought what was interesting, I just paraphrase it a little bit, with respect to the nominalist question, was the term post-structuralist philosophy, or what the Americans, in a kind of McDonaldized form, called postmodernism nowadays. Post-structuralist philosophy is much more complex than what passes off as postmodernism in the American academia. The power of nominalism and interpreting all words as names, arbitrary names. And here I thought there was a very powerful suggestion. Nominalism fails to inject life into language, could not make language take off and blend into meaning and usage, and ended up giving only a truncated blueprint of language. That I thought was very, very interesting. Let me end with the what is philosophy argument in the book, which runs all through. Philosophy has never been accorded a privileged status in Wittgenstein's philosophy. That's an interesting line, actually. And I quote her. Let us see how this fact has been made to lend support to the supposed ineffability of forms of life. For Wittgenstein, there is no isolated realm of philosophical reflection. It is not a self-contained activity providing insights into other activities that remain unaffected by philosophical reflections. For Wittgenstein, a philosopher must speak the language of the everyday. The meanings of philosophical terms are shaped by the customs and practices in which language is used. Now, if like all philosophical terms and phrases, forms of life too has to be used in a form of life itself, and that is very interesting. You cannot be in a form of life to speak on form of life. That Archimedean position is not allowed. The full meaning of this phrase can never be grasped through language. But this realization that does not imply that a philosopher bumps his head against the limits of language argument. And I think in Akedi, you don't say it directly, but I take it to the kind of post-structuralist philosophy we do. The two major trends over there, I leave aside relativism for the time being, but two major trends over there would be the limits of language argument, which finally takes a kind of endpoint form. You cannot go beyond it after a point, and then you would lend ourselves to kind of the impossibility thesis, limits of language kind of argument, and nominalism. Your work raises serious concerns for us. So the point is not to bump our heads against the limits of language argument, rather, which is the kind of, I would say, a very reduced kind of Derrida which circulates in philosophy departments, rather MacDonaldized reading of post-structuralist philosophy as postmodernism and a little bit of relativism, little bit of nominalism, little bit of the limits of language argument and kind of things. Let me end with this, recognition of this, as we have seen, would involve two very, she says, simple insights, but I would say important insights. All explanations absorb the putative exponents and the explanandum into a single whole, where they cannot be mutually externalized to let the one follow from the other. These insights then are exercises within language. One would neither be confronting a transcendental realm of pure subjects, nor would we be enjoying a special epistemological state of mind. So, in that sense, let me end with another very interesting line of the three I read out, two at the beginning, the third I held on. It is not that a new building has to be erected, or that a new bridge has to be built, but that the geography as it is now has to be judged. Philosophy cannot explain meaning by tracing it to anything ultimately given beyond language. The all-important task of a philosopher lies not in replacing one kind of universal for another, putting in a pre-linguistic essence of human behavior for the traditional essences, but in shifting emphasis to something different, something simpler. And that she puts very well. progressively find and attempt to find the simpler sphere to describe meaning. A sphere that is simpler and at the same time more vivid and enriching, the sphere of human life and forms of living. In that sense, language as usage. Two very powerful suggestions in the book. One, the angle of use, the other, the angle of life. I really couldn't have the time or the moments to get fully into it. But I thought it was very interesting to not do philosophy of life, but to place philosophy in life. And the way philosophy has been bereft of life. It's not just to do philosophy of praxis, which is the general philosophical attitude, to do philosophy of, but to reflect on the praxis of philosophy itself. To not to do philosophy of mathematics, but to preface philosophy with mathematics. And that was very interesting. As I said, I don't have questions. I just have three thoughts for you to reflect on. The question of value, in history, in the question of naming, in the question of words, terms, concepts, the weight of a term or a word, the question of time, a little bit over here, and third, a question not to you but to all of us, what would happen to philosophy after later realization? And contemporary attempts by Alan Badiou to return to philosophy. We have to return to philosophy and not be just anti-philosophical or post-philosophical or not to dissolve philosophical problems, but to remain menaced, troubled by the problematizing of philosophy.
So these are my way of thanks a lot, Anup. You know, when I was listening to you, the words that I have written, they seem so new to me. I wouldn't know that, you know, that you have such a wonderful synoptic overview. And it seems that, you know, the book has been recreated by his presentation. Now, there are many things that I would like to talk on because he has given a very thought-provoking set of reflections. But if I start talking about it, the whole evening will be finished. So now, without much, and of course these three suggestions about time, about Paleolini, of course I have to kind of discuss with him regarding the exact nuances of the term and yes, returning to philosophy. That not to dissolve philosophy, the emergent need for returning to philosophy at all. That is also a very important suggestion which I haven't thought about. And now I would, without much ado, hand over to Dr. Nilanjan Bhaumik.
This works. Let me start by, I do have a few questions, but let me start by placing this book with firstly objectively and then subjectively in my own view. So objectively, if you look at the works of Wittgenstein's philosophy of mathematics, so you have a very famous book by Christian Wright, it's called Wittgenstein on the Foundations of Mathematics, very fat. Then you have some discussion of philosophy of mathematics that Wittgenstein has in Kripke's very famous book on rules and private language, very, very famous book. And then there's a book on the tractatus, I believe. I think it's by Frascola, most probably. I think so. It's an Italian scholar or something. But not many people actually approach the tractatus very much. Because tractatus too has some philosophy of mathematics in it. Indeed, one would say that a good deal of it comes from just philosophy of mathematics. But yeah, I mean, not many people actually speak about the tractatus. It's only when I saw Frascola's book that I realized that Yeah, somebody's actually done some original work. You know, I mean, it's like nobody really talks about it. People just say, okay, you know, Wittgenstein said something about mathematics, but nobody looks into it. It turns out Wittgenstein had very interesting and original thoughts about what exactly mathematics is, what is foundations in the tractatus, which were different from Frege, which were different from Russell, and which were different from many other people around. So he had very different opinions. And it seems that he continued to have different opinions as he went along. And these different opinions were sort of not particularly recorded in the so-called history of the foundations of mathematics. They should have been. He differed a lot from Gödel, he differed a lot from Hilbert, even though he learned a lot from all of them. But he also differed a lot from them. So if you look at Fraschkola's book, then you look at Crispin Wright's book, there's also a very famous book by Dummett, but they're not on Wittgenstein, it's on Frege of the foundations of mathematics. So that's like a very famous book. Now if you look at Akshaji's book falls in that specific category. It's a book on Wittgenstein on as an anti-foundationalist on language and mathematics. I'll come back to this anti-foundationalist thing, by the way. I don't think Wittgenstein is an anti-foundationalist person. This is a very strange thing to say, but I don't think he is. He's as much a foundationalist as all the rest are, but he's just a different kind of foundationalist. Subjectively speaking, that's the objective part. Category. It's a very rare book actually. Not many people work on the philosophy and mathematics of Wittgenstein. Some people don't work on it because, you know, like Wittgenstein is an older sort of philosopher. It's not very exciting to work on it. It's just, I mean, maybe in the 60s or 70s you would find it very exciting to work on Wittgenstein, but not now. But this is a very rare book, I mean, in that sense. Subjectively speaking, I will tell you something. When I was a student, and then obviously I have to read Wittgenstein just as all of you do when you are students of MA here. So yeah, I mean, I used to look at books of Wittgenstein and feel very frustrated. Because if you read Tractatus, okay, that's not, I mean, that in itself in some ways is a frustrating book. But otherwise it's an exciting book. But if you read books on the Tractatus, and if you read books on investigation, they are either hopelessly repetitive, such that they don't say anything beyond what Wittgenstein says. They just keep repeating after writing some lines of description, right? So these books don't really mean much. So I was very, very irritated with the books on Wittgenstein. I still remember that I used to be a student in South Campus. So in that sense, I was invisible, right? So I never came to North Campus. So, but I used to have a free run of the library in South Campus. So I used to just read whatever was there on Wittgenstein, and there was lots of stuff there. Most of it was just, I should not use the word rubbish, but yeah, that's what comes to my mind. It's just some rubbish being written by, you know, people who have some time on their hands. Yeah, but then the one book that I read was Tripti's on Rules and Private Language. That was like a great work on Wittgenstein. That's like the last superb stuff that was published on Wittgenstein. Yeah, well, okay, Colin McGinn has a book on Wittgenstein, which is very, very good. It's called Wittgenstein and Meaning. But not many people get into it because it's like post-Tripti and but it's a very, very good one. Very good book on Wittgenstein. Wittgenstein is of course a good philosopher. So, subjectively speaking, when I looked at this book did not give me that feeling. It gave me a very different feeling. This is a highly original work. This is not a work that repeats whatever Wittgenstein says and all that. No, it's actually a very deep. That's why I was putting it in that other category. Not every book falls in the category of Crispin Wright's book or in Tripti's book or like that. No, this book is an entirely different category. This is not some descriptive work on Wittgenstein's philosophy of mathematics or his philosophy of language. No, it is not. It contains a lot of her own insights, which is often not there in any other book. So this is not like a textbook that you have to read. No, it contains the discussion of Hilbert, it contains a discussion of Gödel, it contains a discussion of Russell, how Wittgenstein differed from them. That's not an easy thing to do at all in the first place. Secondly, to make comments on all of them, that's not difficult. That's not an easy thing to do at all. So this book is in a category of its own. It's a remarkable book in many ways. So that's my subjective view of this book, that it just falls in a very different category altogether. Objectively, of course, this is a very rare work of scholarship. Not just scholarship, but there's something new going on in it, which even she may be unaware of it. Often this happens. If you do something new, it happens. If you do something new, you may be unaware of it yourself. That happens a lot. That's not a big deal. But yeah, I mean, subjectively to me, it appears to be a very different work of scholarship. There are endless nonsensical books on Wittgenstein. It's just getting worse and worse and worse. I mean, now it's just like terrible. I just don't look at books on Wittgenstein. The earlier books were not worth looking at. And the ones that are coming out now, they are just terrible beyond belief. hard to imagine why we should not buy them. There are some books that are interesting that have come out. Interestingly, they are written by people who are in literature departments. So, Professor Mitra's book was in an entirely different category. It's a book that is A, readable, B, it's actually telling you something that is different and new from what the rest of the crowd is saying. So that's a remarkable achievement in itself. Just coming back to Wittgenstein had very odd views. Well, by the way, one thing Wittgenstein said which frightened me a little bit, by the way. He said this, that my greatest contribution to philosophy is my philosophy of mathematics. So that's very surprising. I mean, most people think that Wittgenstein is a philosopher of language, he did too many things about philosophy of language, he changed everything around in the subject and all that. But he doesn't think so. He thinks that his greatest contribution is his philosophy of mathematics. So there's been off late a lot of work on this philosophy and mathematics as to what it is, and people have got more and more confused as they've gotten born into it. Because Wittgenstein had endless discussions with Turing, he had endless discussions with other mathematicians, and nobody ever came to any agreement as to what was really happening. He himself seems to have had a very simple view of mathematics. This is something about Wittgenstein you must know. It is that he often said this, that I just want to say one thing, but it's just that I don't find the words to say. So he wrote so many books, well, we put them together, that's all right. He wrote all these books and they are the fat volumes. But he just wanted to say one thing. But it's just that he never found the right way of expressing it. He often said this, philosophy is all about the right way of expressing something. Maybe the best way is the silence. But Wittgenstein's philosophy of mathematics, I said it was not necessarily anti-foundational. Yeah, it is true. It is against foundations in the sense that it is against foundations in the sense of Hilbert, or it is against foundations in the sense of Russell, or it is against foundations in the sense of Frege. Okay, well, that's fine. That doesn't, just because he criticizes them, as he doesn't make him an anti-foundationalist. I don't think so. So what extra reason do we have, just because he criticizes somebody, doesn't make him something else? No, I don't think he's an anti-foundationalist. He's as much a foundationalist as anybody else is. It's just that he thinks that the foundations are rougher, that they are not as firm as you think they should be, or maybe they are firmer than what we think they are, and they are not like axioms and postulates or things like that. No, he thinks that the notion of a foundation is a different notion, that you need to look at it differently. That's what he probably thinks. He has very odd opinions about mathematics which are very close to formalism. This is something I want to actually ask Professor Mitra. Why would she think that this is going against formalism? Wittgenstein says somewhere that if you ask some specific question to God, let's say, so you ask God what is 72 into 99, he says that even God has to calculate and get the answer. That's the heart of his philosophy of mathematics. He does not think God knows the answer in 1 second. So obviously God doesn't have to calculate, right? He knows everything in any case. But Wittgenstein says, no, even God has to calculate, because the heart of mathematics is calculation. No, that's a very formalist position. It just means that even God has to put the symbols on the board. He has to carry out all the symbolic calculations. He has to do all that stuff. Then God has to put down the number that he's supposed to put down. Well, he's not supposed to put down anything, he's supposed to do something and he gets some number, right? Once he's done that, he's got the answer. But even God has to do all this. Not just mathematicians, not just ordinary mortals like us. Even God has to do all this. So that's a very unusual view of mathematics, but it's very close to formalism. Yeah, I agree, it's not Hilbert's formalism, because Hilbert had some opinion. He thought that, well, you know, you construct an axiomatic system, get everything going, get all the proofs from all these signs and the rules of the signs. Wittgenstein believes that they are all signs. He believes that the use of the signs is all that there is. He probably does not believe in the axioms doing anything great. Probably not. And even if he did, it wouldn't matter, I think. What he thinks is that the signs are all that there are and the rules are all that there are. And he doesn't care about whether you do any foundations or you don't do any foundations. That doesn't matter. So it's a kind of reduced formalism. It's a formalism without any specific aim. That's what it is. Hilbert's formalism has an aim. So I will do X, Y, Z, and I get something out of it. And Gödel criticizes and says, this is impossible, how can you do this and all that. Wittgenstein's idea is that if you have a reduced formula, I just believe you use the numbers. That's what mathematics is. You use the numbers, you have been given certain rules, you use it and that's it.
even God has to do this because there are no preordained answers to anything. And if there are no preordained answers to anything, even God has to calculate. So calculation is the heart of mathematics, is the heart of geometry. It's the heart of everything in mathematics. And so Wittgenstein's idea is, in my view, it's a kind of reduced formalism. It is Hilbert's idea, but it is a reduced idea. There are no aims anymore. I don't have to do any great foundations. I don't have to do some great proofing and find out what is a proof and all this. No. I just believe that there are signs. And there is the rules of a sign. There are the rules of a sign. And then there's just the use and that's it. I don't have to have any program or anything around this whole thing. So all this superstructure of Gödel, Hilbert, all this will disappear. Maybe Frege will remain. That's a possibility. I do think that Frege does remain. Frege doesn't really want to talk so much about the foundations of arithmetic as, well, he does. But he wants to speak about what's the logic of the proof. So that's going to remain, but it doesn't bother Wittgenstein very much. I think Wittgenstein always retained a great respect for Frege. You know, I think because he knew that Frege was very different from all the other philosophers. There's just something about Frege that he escapes all these criticisms that are often made about most people. So Wittgenstein always thought that Frege was really special in this regard. But for Wittgenstein, I do believe that he's not an anti-foundationalist. He is in the sense of he's against Hilbert and all these other people. But he is still a foundationalist. He does think mathematics rests on certain foundations. Yeah, there's the use, there are the numbers, here are the rules. But there's nothing else to do. Don't look for any further foundation. That's so that's one thing I wanted to ask Inakshiji, whether she agrees that one can believe that Wittgenstein can still be a foundation. The other question I want to ask is, everyone has to do this in mathematics, right? Everyone who is a philosopher of mathematics has to say this. That what is our account of the necessity of mathematics? 2 plus 2 equals to 4 is obviously a necessary truth. But the fact that all of you are sitting here is not a necessary truth. Some of you might have just disappeared or gone walking around or maybe you never came in the first place. There's nothing necessary about it. But even if the universe doesn't exist, 2 plus 2 equals to 4, it's still the same. So that needs to be explained. And Wittgenstein did. Well, I'm not very sure what his answer is. In the book it says that, well, you know, there is a deep need of conventions and there is a comparison with Ludo, saying that, you know, in the game of Ludo there are some square, you can't put your marker on the square or something like that. So that's just a convention. It's just a hard convention. Yeah, but it doesn't look to me as hard as the mathematical must, so to speak. There's always this whole issue regarding the mathematical must as to how strong it is. A theorem of mathematics is just a theorem of mathematics. It's very strong. There's nothing we can do about it. We can't deny it, we just have to accept it. If we at all understand it. But as long as you understand it, you accept it. So that we need is Wittgenstein, what she describes as a conventionalist position. Is that a satisfying position regarding necessity of mathematics? So those are the two questions I have. One is that can he be described at all as a foundationalist? I think he can be described as a foundationalist. And secondly, is it possible that we should accept Wittgenstein's answer regarding mathematical necessity? That answer has to come. I think Wittgenstein was worried about it. He was pretty confident that he had an answer, but somehow I have never seen this answer ever. What is the exact answer? That I've never really seen ever. There are comparison with games, yeah, well, that's not very convincing. It's nice to compare it with games, but I just don't find it very convincing ever. There has to be something more convincing regarding this answer. I'm not looking for some real numbers floating around. That's not going to convince me regarding the fact that there are some theorems running around here and there. That doesn't mean anything. The point is, I mean, you guys are real enough, but that doesn't make it necessary. So even if mathematical stuff was real, that doesn't make it necessary. So, the idea is that where does the necessity come from? That's the key issue. That's the issue that's been hanging around for like 2000 years. Where does the necessity come from? Has Wittgenstein got a compelling answer? That's my question to Professor. The book is great, there's no doubt about it. This is a book in an entirely different category than most of the other stuff that's published on Wittgenstein. That much I'm absolutely confident about. It's a great book, but it will probably, I mean, like any book on philosophy of mathematics, it will be painstaking reading. But it's well worth reading. That's all I have.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Nilachal. I won't take much time. Let me see that if I can take 5 minutes to say something, to make some responses. Thanks for Nilachal's very, very incisive comments. Now, firstly about foundation, that Vikesha being a foundation list. What I wanted to say that I interpreted foundationism as, I've often told this to many of my students, or my students will be finding me quite repetitive, that by foundationism I mean that there would be the foundation and the founded, that is the experimentum and the experiments. There is an externality between the two, there should be mutual external. And you pose the foundation with the saturated content, saturated full-fledged content, though it is holding itself one step away from the founded. And then, with a magical power, it is entailing what is the founded. Though it is holding itself external to the founded, but it has the whole power to entail what is the founded. This is the ideal of the theoreticians, and here Wittgenstein would say that if you hold it back from the founded, it will never take you to the founded, that it will never do that work of extinction. And if we have to blend it, and if you blend it, then you will be put under the charge of singularity. So that was Wittgenstein's point on the foundationism, and wherever he was thinning out the foundation, that Platonism was thinned down to logicism, logicism was thinned down to formalism, but still, the thinned down reality of the science, that is pre-activational science, that has a sign ontology. And some people have talked about science in terms of with respect to Hilbert. But science have an ontological character which doesn't require any form of living, which doesn't require any engagement, which doesn't require any activation, but it will by itself, it will, it embodies numericity, structure, everything. And then Wittgenstein could say no. Because science also, he has talked about Euclidean diagrams being drawn partially in black and partially in white, or even science having their historicity. Science cannot be terminal units of space which resist all interpenetration. So science also have to blend with a larger landscape of reality. Science cannot have that insular, totally insular, terminal, impenetrable character. And here I would say that whenever we try to chisel out the science in terms of the minimal reality, which is extralogical, which is to be intuited, and where there are no multiply intuitive character, I am inclined to say that this kind of chiseling out and making terminal lumps of space is itself a process of dissipating space. It is as much as you try to thin out or chisel out space to secure the terminal lumps and units of science, the more you do it, the more you disturb space. It's by more dissipating, disturbing, penetrating, messing up space that you try to, chisel out those thinned out units of space. And that is why, I was supposed to say that is why even machines which are made to correspond to science, etc., they do it at the birth of the cost of dissipating reality. So that is what I would say. And about necessity, I just say that Wittgenstein had a way of, turning necessity into contingency and contingency into necessity. I mean, that is most I can say, but I won't go into more detail because there is no time. And about Professor Dhor's, I will just address one comment of Professor Dhor. It was a quotation from Wittgenstein himself, that is essential to the dignity of what he was saying, that essential to the dignity of uniform, that it should be contrasted with civilism. So what Wittgenstein says, that mathematics cannot start in a vacuum. Mathematics should be a contrast of turning the causal game into the reason game, that is freezing. Unless this pre-freezing the causal dissipative character was there, and unless that one learns how to freeze that causal contingency, causal externality into definitions, turning experiments into definition, unless this history is there, maybe that is one way to respond to Professor Dhor's point. paleonymy, unless this history is there, unless the mathematician goes to this tortured historicity, then there is no mathematics. That is why the machines cannot be made to do mathematics. Because the machines don't go to this tortuous historicity. That's all for now, and about Vilanjan's very, encouraging comments that it is a rare book. I would like to read that when I was about to write a, whenever you write a book, you have to write a selling pitch. That is, you have to sell yourself to the publisher, saying that how your book stands unique. So naturally, I had to, kind of think how to make this case talk, and naturally, I wrote this panel, and and I'm happy that, Nilanjan is kind of saying the same thing, that I'll just, read out that para. Later Wittgenstein's views, particularly his critique of foundations of mathematics, are usually found to be counterintuitive and technically wrong, while the various foundationalist versions make a smooth entry into our schemes of thought. Dismissing his later insights or creating an apparently glitching demonstration as to how his views give way under internal inconsistencies is a much easier task than a thoroughgoing defense. It is a latter project with which this work has entasked itself, not in a spirit of sympathetic disposition, but in a spirit of matching my intellectual obstinacy with that of Wittgenstein, often striving to provide better arguments than he himself has done. That is a very, immodest comment, but I was forced to write because I had to sell myself. And not in the spirit of sympathetic exposition, but in the spirit of matching my intellectual obstinacy with that of Wittgenstein, often striving to provide better arguments than he himself has done, often stretching beyond the limits of explicit articulations to a non-standard and polemical mode of interpretation. Overall, this work is a dogged attempt to take anti-foundationalism to the point of its saturation. In the long run, it is for the readers to decide whether this study yields to the pressures of foundationalism or whether it teaches us to assimilate an unavoidable intellectual vertigo into our lives and academics. This often happens, I often fall back into foundationalism. I cannot float myself. It happens before I go to the class. Suddenly, students ask me, I say, I have to lapse down to foundation. Then again, I have to kind of dissipate the thing. So that was what Nilanjan was suggesting, that I have to yield. Wittgenstein has already yielded to the pressures of foundationalism, but I was trying to argue against it, that there cannot be even thinned out foundation, because Wittgenstein wouldn't allow any thinned out foundation which is unenacted, which is pre-activational, which is pre-application. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Dhar, Professor Bhomik, and Professor Nakshi for such insightful deep analysis of the book. Anybody from the audience wants to raise any question, ask any question about today's book reading?
Lanchan was talking about Wittgenstein's formalism. So where I see Wittgenstein's formalism is that in the Tractatus also he says that logical truths for him are tautologies, and that seems like a formalist view of logic and mathematics. So what do you think is the connection between a formalist position and foundationalism? No, ma'am.
Oh, to me? What is the connection between?
His formalism regarding logic and foundationalism in mathematics.
See, what I was trying to say is Wittgenstein was not a formalist. Because to be a formalist, as in Hilbert's sense, that he was giving that, since you, with logicism, you cannot make logic the foundation, because logic itself turns the, turns the essences in terms of rules. Okay. So, so far as the rules are supposed to reign over a vast, unsurveyable mass, and trying to foreshadow that what are exactly the instances of a concept or the rule, in that way, logicism is also lapsing into some kind of realism or Platonism. And so there you see, formalism comes and says that no, you don't have to commit yourself either to rules or to real essences, but it is a sign. Signs themselves are that reality, that they are the numericity, structure, relation, everything is embedded into. So they don't have to go beyond themselves to stand for numericity or structure or relation, because they embody it. So that was what Hilbert was saying, and how science are to be put under a generality, under abstractness, and how this abstractness to again come back to the science is all given, written to the nature of the science. So, and Hilbert says that you can go to abstract, uninterpreted systems from the science and then get the science as their application. So, but here I was saying that, it is true that, you know, Wittgenstein had not given this critical formalism in very explicit terms. But what he had said explicitly is that, you know, against this, this kind of impenetrable character of the science, he has said that. Because science also interact. Science also have, kind of dissipated reality. Science also have this kind of historicity. Science can also be looked upon in different ways. And what I was saying that, you know, if the science come up with this kind of impenetrable, insular ontology, that is because, you know, that thing of foundation, I would venture to suggest that it is a, they take this impenetrability kind of geographical or practical impenetrable. Like you find it geographically difficult to navigate to certain spaces, but space itself cannot be impenetrable. So science also cannot be impenetrable. And to chisel out science, to present science as, you know, impenetrable, as thinly chiseled out, you know, for that you have to do a lot of displacement of space itself. It's only as much you try to make space impenetrable, so much you will disturb reality and order to be. So in that way you see that, you know, Wittgenstein cannot say that, okay, signs are there, or you can artificially construct signs in some, to make them impenetrable, thinly chiseled out thing, and there you can have mathematics within science. So that is the problem. That was what I was trying to say, that, Wittgenstein wouldn't perhaps, agree to Hilbert's suggestion that science have that histological, purely intuitive character, and which actually transparently shows that what generality there has to be put under to, and what are the limitations of science also can be very, very difficult. So that is what I was trying to say. Yes, actually it was a reviewer's suggestion. I didn't have formalism in my original book, but then the reviewer came up with this very valuable suggestion that she has not discussed formalism. I've also, left out, as Vinanjan was pointing, Crispin Wright's discussion. I've also left out Kripke's, rules, what was the name of the book? On rules in private language, which I didn't have time to do. The book was anyway quite long. And I thank, IIAS, because other publishers or professional publishers, they don't go beyond 90,000 words or whatever. But my work was already, it was over 1 lakh. And so but IIAS had been graciously, publishing my books. My next book is 1,75,000 words, and it is only IIAS who will be publishing it. No professional publisher would be taking it. I cannot write short books. Somehow it goes on inflating. Any other? This one? Yeah, I must confess this has a, late, it has a very remote basis in my PhD thesis. But on my PhD thesis, I have, kind of added a lot. I've got very valuable suggestions from my external supervisors, Bob Hale, one of them, Bob Hale, and others, Professor Amitabh Dashgupta, and which I've, put in, and that chapter on supervision, and on Wittgenstein's critique of Frege, that is what I've added, the formalism I've added, and between, my third chapter was very, very weak, when I, put it as my, PhD thesis. But then I made substantial improvements on my third chapter, because I had to read Russell, I had to read Frege. Because I thought that you cannot, to dissipate foundations, to be anti-analytic, you have to be very much analytic. To be critical of analytic philosophy, you have to do it in a very, very analytic way. You simply cannot, kind of do it in a broad brush style. So naturally, I was getting into these proper theories of mathematics, and Russell, Frege, and there many of my colleagues have helped me a lot. Otherwise, I could not have broken into what Russell wanted to say as axiom of reducibility, etc., etc. I could not do it. So, many people's contribution has gone into the Nilanjan, particularly. He saved me on this, adding this chapter in formalism. You say that you reread chapter because I didn't have time to go into very, you know, to very very voluminous books on this. So he suggested that you can go into this book and there you will find a you know, good manageable entry on formalism. And from that, of course, I read some you know, books of Hilbert as well. But that was a, you know, kind of entry point. Shapiro was an entry point to get into the you know, more difficult theories of Hilbert. So formalism was a later addition.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm sorry, we are a little bit late of time, so you can ask the question to ma'am later on.
I'm sorry, actually I forgot about this audience interaction. Otherwise, I shouldn't have talked.
Still, you can talk to her later on. We are very happy to announce our launch of latest publications from this stage, along with today's book reading. So, the books being launched today is Some Essays on Tagore, translated originally from Bengali by Sivesh and Sumita Bhattacharya. In Gandhi's Ark by Professor Sashi Joshi. Bhas Ramayan Plays by Professor Mahesh Champaklal. And Urban Spaces by Professor Partho Datta and Narayani Gupta. Post-colonial Indian Literature by Satish Sri Ekant. And In the Sky of Consciousness by Alexandra Mehta. So for the launch, we also have with us Dr. Ramashankar Singh with us. He is our existing fellow, and I invite him on the stage. We also have with us Deputy News Editor of the Dainik Jagran, Mr. Pranav Sirohi. I invite him on the stage. And also three dignitaries on the stage. Thank you, Dr. Ramashankar Singh and Mr. Suri. We are here, we are available on the stall number 113 at hall number 8 to 11. We are also available on our online bookstore, that is books.iias.org. For better outreach and distribution, we are also available on Amazon. My team, Deepak ji and Tashi ji, and all your audience present here, and all the dignitaries on the stage. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much.